What up, guys? Dreadshells here, and welcome back to World of Tanks. I hope all of you guys had an awesome weekend. Several of you have been requesting in the comments of my previous videos that you guys would like to see more mid-tier and low-tier scout gameplay. So I sat down and had a play session on Saturday in all the tier 5 scout tanks currently in the game to try to get some gameplay to illustrate the attributes of each of these tanks, and so you guys can get an idea of how they play. The first game that I'm going to be showing you guys here today is in the ELC AMX, the Tier 5 French Scout, on Corellia Assault Defense. So let's just get started. Now, the ELC AMX is actually not one of my strongest scout tanks. I actually sometimes downright struggle with it just because I'm not used to the limited gun traverse, and it's not really fitting to my traditional playstyle. I think the ELC AMX is kind of a weird hybrid in between a scout and a tank destroyer, and it also has a lower base view range by a significant margin than the M24 Chaffee or the VK1602 Leopard. It has 360 meters base view range, while the Leopard has 380 and the M24 Chaffee has 390 meters base view range. Actually, this experimenting with a bush here for the first time, trying to figure out if it's effective or not in this particular game. It was the first time I tried using that bush, and I was able to get some effective spots on the enemy as they were advancing into the southwestern corner of the map. In my opinion, the much better spot to fight in on Corellia Assault defense or offense compared to the northeastern corner. But as you can see there, the disadvantage that the ELC AMX has in base view range is more than made up for its epic camo rating. It, I think it has the highest base camo rating of any scout in the game. Let me pull up the stats here. Yeah, 21.89% base camo rating, which is insanely high. And when you take into account that that will increase with the crew camo and other consumables that you might, if you are fancy with using food or anything like that, then it will increase that much more, and you will be able to pull off some insanely how did I not get spotted moments. Using some bush mechanics there with the trees in front of me, staying 15 meters or further behind to keep the KV-13 from spotting me while I was shooting at him. And as you can see there, one of the weaknesses of the ELC AMX is its aim time of its 90mm gun. So the penalty that you have to pay for having such high alpha damage of 240, which is quite unusual for any tank of this tier, is the really, really high aim time. And also it has a really long aim time, so... Kind of making a positional error here. I'm kind of almost putting myself in a pinzer here with the going centering myself in the middle of the swamp. So I have the M5A1 Stuart here on my left, and they have the T1 Heavy on my right, and now I have a T20 further up on the ridge. So, but luckily I get away with it here. Quite surprised that the T20 actually didn't spot me when I was shooting at him. There was a bush in between me and him, right behind him on the ridgeline, but I thought that he had driven past it, so I'm not sure why I didn't get spotted there. Probably a combination of the ELC's great camo rating, and he might have had a poor crew. The T20 actually has a really, really good spotting potential for a Tier 7 medium, and in some ways is actually a better vision tank than the T21. The Tier 6 American Scout tag. And the T21 is actually one of the scout tanks that suffered a lot from power creep, and I hope Wargaming will buff it eventually someday. But now we're running into the other Tier 6 American Scout tank, the T-37, which is a much, much better tank. It's not the stealthiest scout in the world for sure, and not the best vision scout at its tier, but it makes up for it with having high damage potential of its high-performing 76mm gun. I can't remember for sure on that. And quite surprised that the enemy T-37 didn't take the engagement on me for some weird reason. He could have easily ran me and then killed me in one or two shots, but he didn't want to. And our Cromwell on our team back here was able to put one shot into the enemy T-37, which put him down in low enough HP so where I could easily kill him in one shot. The alpha damage of the 90mm on the ELC is quite nice at 240. But once again, the ELC AMX is not one of my strongest scout tanks. Like I said before, I'm still relearning how to play it, as most of the battles that I have in this tank I played before I started to try and learn and understand game mechanics and get better at scouting. So it's definitely a new experience for me, and I'm kind of getting a little bit of a feeling of nostalgia going back and playing these low tiers. So not a huge game, as you guys will see in the stats, but it is a nice warm-up game. And hopefully it give you guys a feel for how good the camo rating of the ELC is so good, and give you guys some idea of the gun handling on the tank as well. But enough of that, let's move on to the M24 Chaffee game that I have for you guys today on Redshire. Alright, so here we are in the M24 Chaffee, the Tier 5 American Scout Tank on Redshire Encounter. And it's a Tier 8 game, so we're bottom tier. And the decisions that we have to make as far as spotting and doing damage have to be a little bit more conservative because of that. Normally I like to go up here to like F4 and E4 at the beginning of the game to try and spot enemy tanks that are crossing across this beeline going up into the castle, and also you might get some backside spots into this D4 C4 area, but it's too risky for me to do that in this particular game, not only because of the tiering that it is, being a tier 8 game and them having a lot of mobility, but because it's Encounter. I'm a lot more tentative about going to this spotting location on this middle ridge here in E3 when it's Encounter, because generally the cap circle draws a lot of quick cap moves, kind of like Moths to a Flame. There's a giant cap circle there, and it seems like always somebody jumps on cab early, so I don't want to be proxy spotted and die in the first 30 seconds. So I'm going to go over here into the riverbed in this F7 area to help spot the C4 camp ridge. What can I tell you about the M24 Chaffee as it is now in the game? Well, it's kind of a interesting scout in the fact that it has 77 kilometers per hour top speed, which is ridiculously fast for a scout of its tier, or a tank of its tier in general. And I'm not sure exactly why Wargaming gave it that high top speed. I don't think it needs anything higher than, I don't know, 65, 66 kilometers an hour top speed, to be honest. But the catch-22 with this tank is that its horsepower to ton ratio is not the best. So while it may have a great top speed, its acceleration to that top speed takes longer than, for instance, the ELC AMX, which has a great horsepower to ton ratio. So it's kind of plays a lot like the rest of the Americans scout line in that regard, at least as to the T-37 and the M-41 Bulldog and the T-49. All of them have decent top speeds, but kind of average or slightly below or average horsepower to ton ratios. But as you can see here from this river position, we can spot that north gap as tanks approach into the 9-0 line brawl area. And we can also spot the C4, C5 sniping area on the ridge behind me where the Skoda T-40 on the enemy team is currently spotted. And if you get spotted here, it's quite easy to drop down and back into cover, at least from the C4 sniping position. It's a little bit more difficult to stay in cover from the gap there in the draw where you see the Tiger and the Tiger P are currently sitting. So it's a little bit of a tricky position to use. Normally when I go here I don't shoot at all, as it's the opportunity to shoot just rarely happens. Tanks rarely stop where this Tiger P and Tiger are currently sitting. Usually because tanks that go over to fight in the 9-0 lines know better than to stop there, because if you see where all my team is sitting currently up there in front of me, the Pershing, the Cromwell, etc., all have really nice shots into where those tanks are currently sitting over there to the 0 line. And you'll notice that with its standard rounds, the M24 Chaffee will struggle to pen a decent number of its shots the higher and higher tier that you get. Of course, that isn't any different than any other tank, but it's a little bit more exponential with the M24 Chaffee. It only gets 96 millimeters of penetration, I think. Yeah, 96 millimeters of penetration with its AP rounds. And the APCR, I'll have to look at that, 143 millimeters of penetration. So you really need to load a decent number of your rounds as premium. It's just kind of the nature of this tank. Of course, if you're playing with a standard account, that might not be a feasible option for you, of course. Another letdown of the M24 Chaffee there is its shell velocity. Its shell velocity is quite low, so it's quite difficult to hit targets on the move at range, especially as it's kind of difficult to predict and lead the targets correctly. It's almost borderline derp gun shell velocity. If you play the VK-2801, the tier 6 German scout tank, you'll have a feel for kind of the shell velocity that this tank has. Not quite that bad, but it's pretty difficult to lead shots. We're able to kill the Lorraine 155-50 there. I'm not sure what he was doing there in that C5 position. He is one of the more mobile arties, so he could have easily relocated over to the 9-0 lines here where his teammates could have helped him. But this game so far has been a kind of a story of giving my teammates opportunities and then recognizing when my teammates give me opportunities, like giving what vision I can in the riverbed there and taking what shots of opportunity I could. And now that my teammates have broken through enemy lines and there's a lot of room for me to maneuver, this is where the M24 Chaffee and really any scout will excel, when there's a lot of open ground for where you can maneuver and flank enemy tanks. So it's really important to try and stay alive as long as possible in a scout, because if you can bide your time and if the circumstances of the battle end up like this, then this is where a scout really shines. I don't want to push the Ferdinand quite yet, and actually he can quite easily one-shot me here. That's something to also keep in mind. So I'm going to pick on this Tiger 2 here. The other reason I didn't want to assault the Ferdinand until now is because if I went around to flank the Ferdinand here, as he was distracted by the T-150 on our team, the enemy Tiger 2 could have easily helped him and just turn around and shot me. So you always need to be keeping in mind when you're looking for flanking opportunities and putting isolated enemy tanks in a Panzer, don't do it at the sacrifice of of putting yourself into a crossfire and putting yourself into a pincer, right? Look for opportunities where you can flank enemy tanks without getting flanked yourself. As you can see here, I loaded some premium rounds as my first couple of AP rounds were bouncing on the Ferdinand, even though we had the side of his tank. Maybe not needed, but 96 millimeters of penetration, he barely has to angle his superstructure and will start bouncing a decent number of shots. So I just didn't want to waste time bouncing half of my AP rounds on him, so I just loaded some premium ammo. And now we have the back of the Tiger II here, and now he's caught out in the open in a crossfire. And unfortunately, our last shell does not land in time, but our Pershing on our team is able to secure the kill. So hopefully this game gave you guys a rough idea on the general attributes of the M24 Chaffee. Really, really excellent top speed at 77 kilometers an hour. A little bit of a sluggish horsepower to ton ratio. I can't remember what that is off the top of my head. I think it's in the low 20 horsepower to ton ratio. The gun on the M24 Chaffee is kind of sub-average. You'll struggle to pen a decent number of your shots, so I would recommend having a significant portion of your ammo loaded as premium ammo. As far as equipment choices for this tank, I think there's quite a wide range of loadouts that you could use on this tank. I personally use a double vision loadout. I use optics, binocs, and then a rammer. But you could use rammer, binocs, and camo net. You could use optics, only optics. Scout has a great view range at 390 meters base view range, which is excellent for a tier 5 scout. So you could actually get away with using coated optics and then vents and rammer. That would also be a decent loadout. So it all depends on your play style and on how good your crew is for the equipment choices. The camo rating of the M24 Chaffee, I don't remember off the top of my head, but I believe it's average to slightly above average. It's adequate. It's not particularly bad, so you're able to use most traditional scouting positions on maps. But enough of that. Let's move on to the final game I'm going to show you guys today in the VK-1602 Leopard on Sand River. Alright, so here we are in the VK-1602 Leopard, the Tier 5 German scout tank, and the final Tier 5 scout tank that's currently in the game. Sand River Assault Defense, and it's a Tier 7 game, so let's just get started. Now, I actually quite like the VK-1602 Leopard. A decent number of players that I get either feedback directly or indirectly say it's not one of their favorite scout tanks, and I can understand why. It's mainly down due to its gun. Its gun is quite difficult to get to work effectively. Mainly down to two attributes of the gun. One is its poor penetration. It has a slightly worse penetration than even the M24 Chaffee, with 95 millimeters of penetration with its standard rounds. Not the best aim shot there. I could have not been lazy with auto aim and actually led the target a little bit, and I might have penned half of my clip. But the other thing that makes it hard to use as far as the gun with the Leopard is the shell range. It has basically the same gun that the Luke's does, except with a couple of extra shells and a little bit better gun handling as far as accuracy is concerned. But the shells actually won't travel beyond 400 meters, I think. I'll have to look that up. So, and the penetration drops off quite a bit at longer ranges, more so than other guns, just because of the small caliber of the gun it is. So, in order to make the gun work effectively, you're going to have to get a lot closer to the enemy to do a significant amount of damage to the targets that you can pen. So, in that regard, it's a lot like the ELC, as far as the ELC, you have to be creative with the mobility of the tank to get vision. With the 1602 Leopard, you have to be creative with the mobility in order to get damage. So, kind of a similarity in that regard. But that is the key to the success of the Leopard there. Find enemy tanks that are distracted, engaging other teammates, and make sure that you are at a good angle to pen them. Fortunately, only pen about half of our clip there. The max clip potential for the Leopard is 360, which is kind of awkward, actually, when you're engaging other scouts especially. You don't have enough max clip potential to kill them, so you have to keep other scouts at range until they have low enough HP where you can kill them with a clip, so you always have to keep that in mind. It's not your traditional autoloader. It doesn't have a high clip potential. But it has a pretty a decent view range at 380 meters base view range, I believe. Let me double check that real quick here. Yep, 380 meters base view range. And its camo rating is actually slightly better than the Chaffee at 16.59%, which is adequate. Its top speed is kind of on the slower side at 60 kilometers an hour, but it has pretty decent horsepower to ton ratio and ground resistance and traverse stats. So even though the M24 Chaffee has a much higher top speed at 77 kilometers an hour, you'll find that the 1602 Leopard is more of a nimble scout tank, shall we say. So it's more agile, and it's able to outmaneuver the enemies when it gets close enough a lot easier. Having the worst clip in history there on the MT-25, as I didn't aim it very well, but luckily he was able to run away. And in this game, you'll notice here that I've always been reacting to what the enemy is doing. When that Panther M10 at the beginning of the game was pretty close to me, I was always prepared to run away, as I actually had no backup here on this middle ramp area, which is kind of unfortunate. I think it's one of the strongest, if not the strongest, position on Sand River Assault, either defensive or offensively. It's a really key position on the map to try to influence or to try to control, as you have a decent opportunity to get vision on the enemy team, and also some crossfire opportunities into the north and into the western side of the maps. But now the enemy have put a lot of pressure in on our zero line area, and there's no one to act as the anvil on my team anymore in that middle ramp area. And those tank destroyers there, that Jackson and the SU-100M1, are up there, and I just can't fight that, and I don't have enough support, so I'm gonna relocate. And I was going to go over here to help the Stir Emil kill the EZ-8, but he was able to handle the situation by himself, so that's nice. I was coming over here just in case. Always find the isolated target, right? At that point in time, the EZ-8 was the isolated target. Pro driving right there, driving into the rock, and luckily not flipping my tank. And now I'm looking for an opportunity to flank here and potentially go for Artie. Always look for the open ground on a map, right? That's what you try to look for in a scout. Find the low health Crusader. I don't want to stick around here too much as the tank destroyers are aware of me, at least the SU-100M1 is. And I saw there on the mini-map that he was charging me, but I know I have enough time to engage at least one artillery here, and I want to be able to kill at least one of them, because I know I won't be able to run away from this SU-100M1, as it is a pretty mobile tank destroyer. I probably wouldn't be able to get back into B1 and C1 in time before he would be able to shoot me. So instead, I decide that I'm going to take the multiple engagement. Luckily, amazingly bounced his first shell on me, which is really helpful. An Artie on our team is able to put a shot into him and track him. And we're able to get it around to his side and to his rear and secure the kill. Now the Jackson is also charging me, so I'm thinking about running away to B1. And then the Stir Emil on my team takes the Jackson out, so now that leaves me free to kill the GW Panther. And now I'm just kind of using this ridgeline here as cover for me as I'm approaching the GW Panther. Unfortunately, get spotted there. The ideal situation when you're approaching any tank is you want to stay concealed until the last possible moment so they have less time to react and turn. And that is what the Leopard can do if the target you are able to pen reliably and if it has low enough HP. Potentially there I could have not one-clipped him as the clip potential on the Leopard, as I said before, is 360 burst damage. So we had, luckily we had enough to kill him, but we might have had to have reloaded there in some situations depending on if we rolled low or not. Now it's just the final Panther M10 on the enemy team trying to cap, which is not the best idea in the world. And unfortunately, he's looking our way. I was thinking that he was actually looking south. So unfortunately, he put a shot into us. More pro driving going over rocks, and once again, luckily not flipping my tank. And now I am praying that I reload in time. I pray, come on, let's get the kill, let's get the kill. Because that final kill meant that I secured a third kill on a target that is two tiers higher than me, which is an Orlix medal. So I knew I was in the running for an Orlix medal because I had already previously killed the E-25 and the SU-100M1 on the enemy team. So I just needed one more kill on a target two tiers or higher than me. So hopefully this game gave you guys a rough idea on the gameplay of the VK-1602 Leopard. Not the fastest scout in the world as far as top speed, but it has a decent horsepower to ton ratio, has adequate camo rating and adequate view range. And once again, my loadout for this tank is actually quite similar to the M24 Chaffee in that I use a double vision loadout. I use coated optics and binocs on it, and vents, I believe. So you can't use a rammer or anything like that as it's an autoloader. And that fit has been working out pretty well for me, but definitely like the M24 Chaffee also, I can see several different viable equipment loadouts that you could use for this tank. I could see you using vents, binocs, and camo net. I could see binocs, vents, and I don't know if it can use vert stabs. I'll have to use double check that. I don't think it can. But it has 380 meters base view range, so it's not highly recommended that you use only coated optics as a vision equipment slot. You can potentially use just that and get away with it if you have a really, really good crew. But I would definitely probably always use binocs on this tank as you can get into tier 8 games, and there's a decent number of tier 8 tanks that have really good view range, so you don't want to be outspotted by tanks when you're bottom tier. Also, hopefully you guys got an idea of the gun and how it works, how to make it work effectively. You have to get a lot closer to the enemy than you're used to in order to get effective damage and be able to penetrate targets effectively, which is the awkward and difficult part of playing this tank. So a lot of that has to do with try to find isolated tanks. When you're going through the battle countdown timer, just go through the team list and already predetermine in your mind which tanks can I pen, which tanks can't I pen. If I can pen them, how can I pen them? And in that regard, it's a lot like playing a derp tank with HE rounds, like playing a KV-2 or a T-49. You know which tanks you can pen with HE, and so you're going to have to be a little bit more micro analyzing in that regard, as you have such a low penetration at 95 millimeters with standard and only 110 with your premium ammo, so that's not much more. So analyze the enemy tanks and try to pick out targets that you can harass while they're distracted by your teammates. Hope you guys enjoyed this video today and got some good perspective on all three of the tier 5 scout tanks that are currently in the game and how they're all different, and their strengths and their weaknesses, and how their play styles differ to play successfully. Wish you guys the best of luck in these tier 5 scout tanks as you work on whatever missions or marks of excellence or trying to ace or whatever you like to work on in World of Tanks. Happy hunting and take care.